Okay, so we're going to go straight to the big topics. As a cross-cultural psychologist, which you have to explain to us exactly what it is, what are the biggest forces that you see changing relationships in our time?
So I look at how relationships change as they are affected by big cultural shifts. And the cultural shifts that I've traditionally looked at is migration, forced migration, and voluntary migration. How does this change the way people relate, what they expect from their relationships, how they structure their relationships, and the meaning they give to them? I look at mixed marriages, racial, cultural, and religious intermarriage, which are also people who are in cultural transition, but it happens in their own living room. And I look at what happens to relationship when the political regime changes, like the fall of communism, or the shift from collectivist to individualistic societies, which means the shift from relationships that have been traditionally structured around duty and obligation and loyalty to relationship models that are much more centered around free choice, individual fulfillment, pleasure, and happiness. So that's as a start.
So let's take it, that's a pretty big opening. Let's start unpacking one after the other. So let's talk first about the changes across different countries and different states. For instance, you just came back from Denmark.
Yes.
When you saw a country that's very different than the US in their values and socialism approach to things, yet what do you learn about relationships there?
Well, it's a very interesting thing. I just went to India, Argentina, Denmark, and Belgium. And that gives you a good sense of cultural shifts. And the question I had in Denmark, every country kind of organizes itself around the central question for me. Here is this country that doesn't have any of the stressors that a typical marriage in the United States may have. They have affordable childcare, they have maternity leave, they have paternity leave, mandatory paternity leave for that matter. They have free education and free health, and their divorce rate is utterly rampant. Why? What is still not good there? What are they still so? And, you know, so I go from that very, probably the most egalitarian society together with Sweden. And then I compare that with Argentina a month before. And I compare that with India just before that. And I look at, is a marriage between two individuals or between two families? That's one big one. Who owns the sexuality of women? Who controls the education of the children? Is there a way out of relational misery? Or is the only way out that you die sooner? Which was the model that we had here not too long ago. You know, what are the power dynamics? And how do the power dynamics mirror a more kind of confrontational, overt model that you have in the more egalitarian societies versus the more indirect model of power in which you don't wield public power, but you have a way indirectly to know how to make the person believe that they do exactly what they want when they're in fact doing exactly what you want?
So let's talk about specific type of relationships. We in the US have kind of a standard model relationship. We get married at a certain age. We think that we're going to be married for a certain amount of time. This changes.
No, this has changed.
Okay, so I was going to ask you, when do you think, what's ahead of us? And what would be your advice to a couple that's right now getting into this?
Right. So I am still a therapist on a daily basis. I think if you look at the States, you probably could take three major segments. You could look at the traditional marriage, the boomer marriage, and the millennial marriage, grosso modo. You know, the marriage which was very much centered around the family, a marriage that didn't have divorce laws, a marriage that didn't have adultery laws, a marriage in which basically you got married for the first time for life, a marriage where you had sex for the first time. Today, a marriage is when you have stopped having sex with others. You know, a marriage where monogamy was one person for life. Today, monogamy is one person at a time. And people tell you that they are monogamous in all their relationships, and this makes perfect sense. A marriage in which women stayed in order to preserve the family, and basically because they didn't have the alternative choice. We know worldwide that when divorce is an option, it's women who take the option. And then from there you go to the boomer. This is very gross, but you know, and what you have for the first time is contraception. You have feminism, you have the gay rights movement, and you have contraception. And you have probably one of the biggest shifts, which is the changing meaning of sexuality in marriage. Until then, it was a procreation model, and it was a marital duty for women. And now it becomes no longer just sexuality. It's not just a feature of our biology, a part of our condition, but now it becomes a part of our identity. And now it becomes something I define, I choose, I create a lifestyle around, I attach values to, and we have a model of sexuality that is part of, that is rooted, not rooted, organized around the concept of desire, to want it, not just to do it because I have to. That's no longer okay. Now it's because I want to. And everybody lives under the tyranny of desire and of wanting it. And then you have another major shift, which is that for the first time, you don't just divorce because you are unhappy, but you are able to divorce because you could be happier. And that shifts the whole thing. So now, how do I know? How do I know this is good enough? How do I continue to rationalize staying or not staying? And we live twice as long as 100 years ago. And so the longevity has shifted all of that. And then you come to the millennial. And the biggest shift is that people used to marry at 22, which in the States, which was pretty much what you call the cornerstone marriage. I marry you, and together we're going to build our home. We're going to develop ourselves, our family, first child, you know, turning the garage into a bedroom, the whole. And now we have capstone. At 29, I meet you, and I meet you, you know, in a whole new sphere. I meet you online. I meet you with a paradox of choice. I meet you with options I never had. And I meet you with the uncertainty and the self-doubt that all these options give me. How do I know you're the one? How do I know? How do I know it's worth stopping my whole nomadic life to choose you? And that question cripples a lot of people. And I choose you, and now you choose me. And that, the one, has been invested with the greatest mountain of expectations a single relationship has ever been bestowed upon. And that means that you're going to be my best friend, my intellectual equal, the best parent, my trusted confidant,